Hello and welcome to the second part of the introduction to the principles of management. In last lecture we came up to the evolution of the management. From this lecture we will continue the same chapter, the next topic under the unit 1 introduction of the principles of the management is the purpose of the management. So for what purpose the management is existed in the enterprise to run the organization, we will discuss from this lecture. So first point is the reducing the ambiguity in methods of working. So whatever the methods of the working existed in the organization by the management or the before the management, and how the work is carried out in the organization, in the enterprise. So role of the management is to reduce the miscommunication, ambiguity, chaos in the working and enhance the method of the working to carry out the smooth working of the production processes, manufacturing processes, administration, etc. and related activities. So it's basically to keep the cost down. To basically costs are related to the production cost. The first things came to our mind by reading the cost in case of the manufacturing industry is to reduce the production cost. So every enterprise intended to reduce the production cost first. So by reducing the production cost, the enterprise will able to reduce the selling price of the product, and obviously they can improve the profit margins. So, and also motivating others to do the same. So first time they will reduce the cost and motivate the other departments also, that keeping the examples in front of them and convince them to reduce the costs of their departments. So taking calculated risks, it is an important feature of the management. So in last lecture we termed the management as the art and science mixture. So here comes the point under which the term fitted well. So it takes the calculated risks, so it needs the concepts of the management and also arts. So judgment of the experienced persons, the past history, forecasted data of the demand from the market. So on that basis, the management will decide how much production we have to carry out in the manufacturing industry, and by reversing the activities of the enterprise, they will decide the planning, the production planning, material requirement planning, etc. So on that basis, they took the calculated risks. Next is the managing prospective risk. So whatever the risk they took, they have to manage it, and their role is to manage it. For that purpose, the enterprise is paying for. Exercise good judgment. So they have to maintain, they have to judge it well depending upon the past history available and the available data of the market analysis, available data of the competing enterprises. Whatever the scenario they are getting in day-to-day activities, they have to apply it. They have to apply the knowledge of the mathematics, science, and do the good judgment for the sole benefit of the organization. Here we started next topic, the schools of management theories. So we seen that management evolved from the ancient world up to the modern era, and lots of water have flown under the bridge. So management theories, schools are developed, and various contributors have contributed into that. So we are studying the concepts by proposed by the various contributors. So various approaches to study of the management by specialists or the contributors from different disciplines, we are terming it as a schools of management thought. The first is the scientific management. It is proposed by F.W. Taylor. So this approach expounds that maximum efficiency is obtained by breaking down tasks into each component moment. So he focuses, he relies on, so took a smallest or minimum or minimalist task and breaking down into small pieces of the task. Suppose a task is to lift the drilling tool from the tool rack and mount it on the lathe machine. So this task will broken down into the minimalist task. Suppose searching for the drill tool, going towards the drill tool rack, grasping the drill tool rack, lifting the drill tool rack, again coming back to the machine tool. That's how the works are disintegrated. And studying each task, that what task is really important and what task is wastage, and reducing the task by incorporating the new ideas or new strategies. It is how we are applying the scientific management. So this was the most efficient and best way of doing each and every work. So this was the forerunner of work study. Whatever we discussed here is included in the time and motion study. And studying the work or doing the work in what method is included in the work study. So in Taylor's model, the relationship between manager and the employee is of the master servant or the parent child. In that case, the master instruct or give the set of instructions to the servant, and servant will follow that set of instructions to do the work. So here is the same case in the organization, in the scientific management philosophy. So next contributor is the Mayo. He proposed the Hawthorne studies. It is the most quoted approaches in the people's management. He studied at the Hawthorne works of Western Electric in Chicago. His finding showed that the productivity of the workers will improve when working conditions between employees and management will improve. So whether they are improving or not, the working, how much are the working conditions between management and employee is of the much significance. So his major contribution into the motivational theories. So his work concluded that the difference between the management and employees was a result of feeling or unfeeling the part of the team. And this leads to a new idea that workers should be considered to be a part of the social organism rather than individual cogs in the large wheel. So they should be treated as a group members, not an individual entity of the enterprise. So that's how the motivation works, and we will bring out the highest productivity in the enterprise. Next is the Theory X and Theory Y by MacGregor. The theory suggested two different styles of the management based on the assumptions of the employee's motivation. The Theory X requires carrot and stick model of motivation, and Theory Y places problems of human resources, problems of people, into the lap of the management, to in front of the management. So people will exercise self-direction, self-control in the task associated for them in the achievement of the organizational objectives. So if they are committed to those objectives, if they are committed only there and then, they will self-direct, self-motivate, self-control to achieve the goal. So theory Y suggests that the authority and control are not appropriate for all purposes under all circumstances, because some peoples, or depending upon the theory X and Y, the people will exercise self-direction. They will selfly motivated, selfly directed, selfly controlled, and that's how they will achieve the goal of the enterprise. Next is the job enrichment. It is proposed by Herzberg in 1960s. So he differentiated between motivational and hygiene factors. The latter being such thing as salary and working conditions. So all the things, motivational and hygiene factors, also salary and working condition, are important. And he differentiated them. So his work suggested that to any attempt or any try to enrich an employee's job, management often succeed in reducing man's personal contribution. So every man is tried to contribute it, and that's how they are getting the satisfaction about the work they're doing. So rather than giving them an opportunity for growth for his job, they are reducing their personal contribution. So he called this as the horizontal loading. So he suggested merely enlarges the meaninglessness of the job. So by doing this, the management is increasing the meaninglessness of the job, unnecessary things in the job. Next contribution, the schools, is the hierarchy of the needs. It is proposed by Maslow. So he proposed that there is a series of needs of the each individual to be satisfied. So if the one need is satisfied, the satisfaction itself ceases to be importance. So if management satisfies one need of any individual, suppose there is one person, he has some need, suppose management satisfies his need, then the importance of that need to that individual will end. The implications for management are an awareness of these needs and action to satisfy them. So management should be aware to that need and should take an action to satisfy it. So that's how they will keep the harmony in the group of the organizations. Next one is the clarity of the roles. It is proposed by Jacks in the 1950s. While earlier Maslow, Herzberg and McGregor have the expertise, or they proposed some theories in the management and motivational theories in 1960s and 70s, the Jacks researches about the key for management of the people was to have clearly defined, and also the roles and responsibilities. So that's how we are keeping the boundaries of each and every individual, and we will try to fix the accountability of each and every individual. He suggested that the lack of clear boundaries caused confusion, which led to frustration, insecurity, and need to avoid accountability. So accountability is of prime concern from the enterprise perspective, and insecurity about the job is of the prime concern from the individual perspective. So to avoid the confusion, he has suggested we have to fix the responsibilities and roles of each employee. Next one, famous contributor, he wrote many books in the fields of management, such as the management tasks, responsibilities, the practice of the management, by Peter Drucker. He proposes the management practices. He wrote virtually on every aspects of the management. He says that the management distinguishes from the workers in respective or in context of the education. So managers are well educated than the lower level management, or specifically workers, laborers. So key role of the management, or they have to contribute in the organization about the vision and implementation of the mission and vision to the workers. So he proposed management by objectives, risk-taking decisions, strategic thinking, and building an integrated team. So next term is the management by objectives. So Boston Consulting Group also contributed into the management by objective, as well as Peter and Drucker. So the term learning curve, growth share matrix, stars, dogs, cash cows, question marks, and the Boston box will be familiar to the users of this approach. Here we are, our prime concern is to learn only the schools, not to learn these things. Any individual is interested in learning these things can go into deep into that. So he centered again about the scientific management school. The use of decision trees is prevalent. He focuses mainly on investment strategies. So decision making strategies will change programs are often led by this approach. The next school is the Japanese management, proposed by Pascal and Althaus. He uses 7-5 framework and made comparison in the US and Japanese management. So Pascal felt that early managerial theory was significant for what it left out, for example, total absence of attention to building a corporate team. So, or to the recruitment and selection of staff, or to training or socialization within the working teams. He suggested that field identity value should be acknowledged. So recruiting, the selection of the staff for the particular work, the training the staff or training the workers, socialize them is of valued. Next is the change movement by Cantor. His views focus on flatter hierarchy. Next one is the search for excellence. So he suggested that leadership is patient, usually boring coalition building. The key of this approach is, however, is built on the 7S as Pascal and Althaus model, so which operate with superordinate goals and strong cultures. So we will look into the principles of management next. So the principles of management suggested by the Fayol. So while putting the principles of management, Fayol warned about they should be flexible and not absolute. The principles of management while implementing should be flexible. They should not be strictly implemented as it is in the enterprise. As well as the principles of management used with intelligence of the management and with the proportion. They should not be applied from the top to the bottom of the level of the management with equal proportion. There should be a decided proportion, how much we have to apply them and in what proportion. And by applying or while applying, we have to apply the intelligence by considering the various issues and scenarios at each level of the management. The first principle is the division of the work. He divided work as a mental and physical work.
to give the maximum productivity and efficiency. So division of the labor and specialization. The labor work which is done at shop floor and the specialized work, they should be divided. Authority and responsibility. The right to give the order is called the authority. So authorized person will give the order to the subordinate person and carry out the work. So this is the authority. And obligation to accomplish is the responsibility. So responsibility of the individual is something that the work allotted to them is their responsibility to carry out or to finish it within the stipulated time or the within the stipulated parameters. While authority and responsibility existed together, they cannot be isolated. Wherever there is authority comes the responsibility. Suppose supervisor or foreman giving orders to the workers regarding anything, he has an authority to order them about the work or to carry out the work. He has also responsibility that the work should be done by the worker within the stipulated time or the stipulated within the stipulated parameters, and he is liable for whatever the work done by the worker, the quality of the worker, the quantity of the worker, he is responsible for that. The complementary and mutually interdependent. They are complementary to each other and depending on each other equally. So that's how they cannot be differentiated or they cannot be separated from each other. Discipline. The entire organization should be disciplined in order to achieve the goal of the organization. Otherwise, smooth running of the organization will not be there, and thereby the problems will occur in achieving the goal. The objectives, rules and regulations, the policies and the procedures should be clearly defined. Rules should be clearly set, and also regulations, objective should be clearly discussed with each and every level of the organization. Procedures about and policies about the work should be clearly defined and laid out on the paper. Penalties for non-obedience or indiscipline is the must. Otherwise, the disciplined workers will deviate from their discipline and will try to behave like the workers behaving in disciplined manner. So penalties will be applied on indisciplined or non-obedient employees in order to maintain the smooth run of the enterprise. Unity of the command. So instructions will be received to the bottom of the management from only one top management person. So thereby we will avoid the confusion, we will avoid the chaos, we will maintain the smooth communication and avoiding the miscommunication. Unity of the direction. They should work together to accomplish the common objective. All the group members should be work together to finish the tasks allotted to them. Emphasis on subordination of personal interest to general or common interest. So we are going from the personal interest to the group interest, and we are trying to focus on the group interest and neglecting the personal interest. So neglecting here means mainly prioritizing the group interest, and we are keeping the individual interest as a secondary. So principles of the cooperation. The cooperation is the must in the group. So each shall work for all, and all for each means each individual in the group will work for the group, will work to achieve the goal of the group, and entire group will work to achieve the goal of the enterprise. Remuneration, fair pay with non-financial rewards, it is motivation. So motivation is a key concern, key parameter to maintain the higher energy level of the group to carry out the task allotted to them, to carry out the goals allotted to the enterprise or the organization. So elimination of the exploitation of employees, workers, labor should be strictly eliminated. Centralization, so balance should be maintained between the centralization and the decentralization. Scalar chain, the scalar word here denotes the steps, the hierarchy. So from the top level management to the worker, the bottom level management, we have to maintain a single chain, a single scalar chain, in order to get the definite orders from the top to the bottom, and issues or any concerns will be reported to the top management through the same chain. Order, the Fayol suggested that there is a place for everything. So equity, an organization consists of a group of people involved in joint effort. So there should be an equity among all group members. They should be equally treated. Stability of the tenure, the person needs time whenever he entered into a new organization. Whenever a person is recruited into the organization, he needs some time to absorb the things, to get into that situation, to get used to it, to the situation. Hence, employees and managers must have job security. The security of the income, employment is a prerequisite of sound organization and management. They are the basis of any employee, the security of income and employee. On that basis, employment and income, on that basis, the worker or any employee will work to effectively and efficiently in the enterprise. Spirit of the cooperation. The sound organization requires the cooperation, wherever the union is the strength in the group. But unity demands the cooperation. Whenever there is unity, it requires the cooperation. The pride, loyalty, and sense of belonging are responsible for good performance. Whenever people are working in the group, the pride of working in the group is required to be to feel a good about the group, to give a loyalty towards the group is the important. Initiative. Whenever there is a person or employee of the enterprise comes with an initiative of a new task, he should be appreciated. He should be given a rewards in any terms. The creative thinking should be appreciated, and managerial planning and execution is required for them. So here we end our first unit. The unit 1, we divided whole subject into the units, and unit 1 we took the introduction to the principles of management and economics. So at the end of the presentation, we took an exercise. We name it as Think Bank 1 for the Unit 1. Here, you have to see the questions, observe the questions, understand it, create your opinions, and express your opinions on the paper. Here, we will look how to create the opinions. Reading the first question, identify the non-economic rewards given to the employees at any one company of your choice. Here you have to identify any company or recognize any company, observe any company, organization, business, firm nearby your site, any retail shop, any wholesale shop, any fabrication shop, any hospital, any organization, any bank, anything. You have to observe it, any public limited company, any private limited company, you have to observe it and observe the rewards given to the employees in that organization and enlist them. Second is the illustrate an example of managerial activities you ever involved and enlist the purposes of each of them. Here you have to enlist the managerial activities done at the organization, whatever you are observed, and enlist them, why or and what purposes they are doing that. So at last you have to create some points and note down some points regarding whether the management is in science or art or both. So we discussed that thing and we have to express in your own words on the paper. Thank you for patient listening.